If you've grown up in India, there's a good chance that at some point in your life, you either considered the option of preparing for government job exams or at least had some relative or friend suggest that government jobs are a lucrative and stable career path. But why exactly is our country so obsessed with the prospect of obtaining government jobs? Do we ever watch Western TV shows or movies and see kids enthusiastically talking about their plans to join the bureaucracy? Not so much. Of course, part of the answer to why government jobs are so sought after in India is that they're seen as respectable, powerful, and stable positions. And it can also not be denied that there are at least a discernible chunk of aspirants who may be incentivized by the prospect of illegal gratification that many of these jobs offer. But one of the biggest reasons, which does not get talked about often enough, at least not in depth, is just how well paid most Indian government jobs are in comparison to the private sector. In the private sector, there is literally no bottom to what salaries can be paid to workers and employees. Of course, minimum wage laws exist from state to state, but these are mostly restricted to the paper they are written on. On the other hand, government job salaries are paid in strict accordance with clearly delineated pay scales. After the 7th Pay Commission's recommendations were accepted by the central government, the bare minimum basic pay per month for a central government employee is Rs 18,000. But basic pay generally just covers 35 to 50% of a government employee's salary, and they also receive several other allowances like dearness allowance, house rental allowance, travel allowance, etc. All in all, even a Group D entry-level government employee can comfortably take home 20 to 25,000 rupees a month, with his pay increasing with years of service. These are people employed as attendants, sweepers, peons, etc. With all due respect to the dignity of their labor, will anyone offer them the same salary along with medical benefits and guaranteed job security in the private sector? Well, outside of tier 1 metro cities, it seems quite unlikely. Let's take another example, that of government school teachers. A postgraduate teacher who gets recruited to teach in a central government school like a Kendriya Vidyalaya can expect to receive a starting salary of Rs 60,000 right off the bat, with senior teachers making up to more than Rs 1 lakh. This is not even mentioning annual paid vacations and stellar medical coverage. Even at the state level, a government school teacher can easily receive a starting salary of Rs 30,000 to 50,000. It is not uncommon to have teachers in some states taking home salaries of more than 60 to 70,000 rupees after just a few years of experience. But can you imagine a private school paying anywhere close to the same salaries in even a state capital, let alone in small towns and rural areas? Of course not. You often have private school teachers with the same role in the same city making one third of what a government school teacher gets paid. And usually, it's the private schools where students perform much better and actually receive an environment conducive to learning. Government school teachers are notorious for absenteeism, archaic teaching methods, and an overall lackluster attitude towards their jobs. Yet, they seem to be compensated much better than their private counterparts. Overpaying employees who underperform relative to their private peers is something which can be seen in public sector undertakings as well, which are also managed by the government. One glaring example of this is BSNL, which in the financial year 2018-19 spent 75% of its total revenues on employee costs. Meanwhile, a notable private telecom player, Bharti Airtel, only spent 4.6% of its revenues on employee-related expenses in that year. And what's the end result of all this splurging on employees? Well, in the same financial year, BSNL suffered a loss of 14,202 crore rupees, or nearly $2 billion at the time. Even as it is firmly established that the public sector is paid too handsomely vis-a-vis the private sector in India, someone may perhaps argue that this is not unique to India and happens everywhere. Well, let's then have a comparison of compensation which government officials receive in India with what they receive in other countries. Of course, there can be no direct comparison of compensation due to different levels of economic development in other countries compared to India, but we can certainly see what other countries pay their government employees relative to their national per capita income and then compare the same metric with India. Do note that in these comparisons, the term compensation will refer to not just the salaries but also the social safety contributions that the said employees receive. Now, to get started, the ratio of the average starting compensation of middle school government teachers in Canada to that country's per capita income is 0.84, meaning that the starting salary of a middle school teacher of a government school in Canada is on average just 84% of the per capita income in that country. In Germany, the same ratio stands at 1.07. In Greece, it goes much lower, standing at just 0.68. Well, let's now calculate this ratio for India, shall we? Now, the teachers who would be teaching middle school children in India in government schools would be paid under the Trained Graduate Teacher or TGT grade. Under this category, the gross compensation for a fresher teacher can conservatively be put at 50,000 rupees per month, which translates to about 6 lakh rupees every year. In 2019, India's per capita GDP stood at about 1,47,000 rupees, which gives us a ratio of 4.08. This means that the starting compensation of government middle school teachers in India is more than 4 times the per capita income of the country. It's not only in the teaching field that this massive difference in government pay exists. Let's look at how clerical or secretarial staff in government departments are paid relative to the national income in various countries. The ratio here stands at 1.21 for Canada, 1.35 for Germany, and 1.68 for Greece. Clerical staff in India generally belong to the Group C category of government employees. The average compensation here can conservatively be put at about 60,000 rupees per month, higher than the starting salary of the teachers, since we are discussing average pay here and not starting pay. This translates to 7,20,000 annually, and hence we get a ratio of 4.9, meaning that on average a government clerk is being compensated with an amount that is nearly 5 times India's per capita income. What about at the managerial level? Does this difference also exist there? Well, to start with, in Canada, the ratio of compensation received by mid-level government managers to national per capita income is 2.9. In Germany, they make 3.47 times the national per capita income, while in Greece, the ratio stands at 2.53. For India, we'll take a conservative estimate of rupees 12 lakh per year based on a public sector bank branch manager's annual compensation. The ratio for India then comes to 8.13, meaning a mid-level manager in a government department or public sector company in India makes more than 8 times the national per capita income. What all this data proves to us is that we are paying unusually high salaries to our government workers relative to our economic capacity as a country. The result of this is that our public sector remains abysmally small relative to the massive task at hand of catering to the needs of such a large population. Publicly available data from the International Labour Organization shows that India may have the lowest rate of public employment in the whole world, standing at just 3.8%. In comparison, this stands at 26.3% in Egypt, 21.5% in the UK, 11.5% in Mexico, and 8% even in our next door neighbor Bangladesh. To adequately provide public services and ensure smooth administration, we need to ensure that we have enough personnel in government departments. And the only way to do that is to make sure we're paying them near the market rate. Otherwise, we just won't have the money to recruit the necessary number of people required to do the job. Moreover, we must ensure that the pay of government employees isn't mostly linked to the number of years of experience after getting into a particular position, but is rather primarily determined by merit and productivity. Extremely meritorious individuals should be rewarded even more than they are currently, and it does make sense to ensure that senior officer and executive level salaries are raised to be comparable to their private sector counterparts. To put it succinctly, the government must not continue to overpay its employees at the bottom while underpaying at the top. The Indian state's old pre-liberalization social justice mentality needs to be chucked out of the window for us to progress as a country. With that, we'll wrap this episode up, guys. I hope you enjoyed watching this video. Do subscribe to the channel for more such content. You can also support Frontier Indica by becoming a patron on Patreon or making a one-time donation through Razorpay. The links for both of these options have been provided in the video description itself.